Y'all want to go back into worship real quick? How many of y'all just love coming into the house of the Lord and worshiping our God? Man, there's no place I'd rather be than in church. I was telling some of our team members this morning, we were outside. It was early. Praise God, the rain held off. I literally prayed for that last night. I was like, Lord Jesus, I'll do anything if you keep the rain away from us while we were putting out parking flags. And he did it. And we were out there just loading in, setting up these parking flags. And I had a moment and I just looked at my boy Gene out there and I said, bro, I don't know where I'd be without church. Anybody else know what I'm talking about? I don't know where I'd be without church. I don't know where I'd be. I grew up in church and then I was away from church for 10 years. And man, now that I get to help lead the way and build the church, the kingdom of God, I don't know where I'd be without it. I need it. How many of y'all know we need church? We need church, man. And there's so many other people that we know that need church. And so I want to challenge you with something today on the front end. Invite somebody to be a part of this series with us the next few weeks. We have a series that we're starting today called Live Rich. I'm going to walk us through four particular things I'll talk about here in just a moment. But I want to teach us how to live a rich life with Jesus that he told us he wanted to live in John 10:10. His purpose is that we would have a rich and satisfying life. So we're going to talk about a few topics over the next 4 weeks. But the way we build the church is to invite. History is, it's all throughout history and it still stands today that the greatest way to get somebody in church is a personal invite. Say invite somebody, just be like, you don't want to, I'm telling you, you gotta be in church. I need church. I think the natural tendency is we're having a bad day, it's raining, we're like, I'm not going today. That's when you need to go. How many of y'all were encouraged last week? I was encouraged last week, man, just keep going. I hope you had a great week. And I'm fired up for this word today because we're gonna be talking about faith, how to live rich in faith. And so I hope you're ready to take some notes today. I got a lot of scripture. Anybody like a lot of scripture? I got a lot of scripture today, okay? I'm gonna do a little more teaching today, but before we jump in, y'all give it up for my man Alvin on the keys, Trove Heights Worship doing a great job. We're gonna jump right in today to the word because I'm just fired up about this word. Let me just tell you, I got way too many notes today. I won't get through all of them, but I've been chewing on faith this week. And God is gonna give us a special word. I'm praying that he gives you what I like to call a faith lift. That maybe you walked in today, if you had any bit of doubt, if you had discouragement. That's why we talked about encouragement last week. I think God is gonna give us a powerful word today that if you walk away and you go ahead and implement this in your life, I think God can strengthen your faith. And that's my only goal out of today is that you can walk out and figure out how to live rich in faith. Because how many of y'all know the Christian life is built on faith, whether you know this or not? Like everything, we are saved by faith. Everything in our lives as Christians is built on faith. I have a brother who's very far from God. He's a few years younger than me, raised in the same house. But as we veered off the path and ran from God for many years, he's still living that lifestyle, but he took it a whole step further. And he's not an atheist, he's not an agnostic. I can't even remember what the term is, but he doesn't believe what we believe, I'll say that. And his problem is he'll call me and he'll say, don't you think it's a problem that what you do is built on faith? And I'm like, it's faith. I got faith in the faith in my God, right? It's built on faith. So this is a staple of the Christian foundation is faith. If you ain't got no faith, you probably ain't gonna make it in this journey very long. So today my goal is to strengthen our faith. How do we develop strong faith so that we can become rich in faith? And we pulled our dream team and I thought, okay, we're gonna talk about how to live rich over these next 4 weeks. What do I need to talk about? So I pulled our dream team. There's about 60 of us and I pulled them. I gave them 10 topics. Hey, if you could hear about any four topics, what would you wanna hear about? How many of y'all know the bottom topic was love? I thought we apparently don't need no love around Trove Heights. I don't know what that's about. I just thought it was funny, but I thought here were the top four topics. We're gonna talk about faith, we're gonna talk about relationships, we're gonna talk about purpose, and we're gonna talk about discipline. That's our next 4 weeks. So hopefully one of those speaks to you, but I thought as a pastor, as your pastor, I can't get up here and try to talk to you about something before I talk to you about faith. Faith is the foundation. So we're gonna talk about faith today. So let me just tell you, I'm gonna give you a lot of scripture, probably way too much for you to write it down. I would write down the references. I'd type them in your phone. You can go back and find them later because I got way too much scripture in here. But today I wanna just teach us and unpack how to develop strong faith. And it's all through scripture. So I'm gonna give you a bunch of it. Go, write as fast as you can. You can take pictures of the screen, do whatever you need to do. But I'm telling you today will help you. I got way too many notes. We'll see whatever God wants to say. That's what I'm gonna say today, whatever God wants to say. And I believe today's gonna fire us up. But what I need is for you guys to amen, shout me down like you're talking to God. Can y'all do that? We got the church folks in here today. All right, we're gonna have some church today. We're gonna talk about developing strong faith today. And John 10:10, it is really the base scripture verse of our vision of our church. John 10:10, I love the way the New Living Translation says it. The thief's purpose is to steal and kill and destroy. Jesus, these are Jesus' words, my purpose is to give them a rich and satisfying life. God wants to give you a rich life. Now, it doesn't mean you're gonna be a millionaire. You might be. Chances are you're probably not, because there ain't that many of them in the world. I don't know if y'all knew that or not. All right, that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about how do you live rich in faith and discipline and purpose and relationships and love and generosity? How do you live rich in those things? That's what he's talking about. And so I'm gonna start us off today with faith. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16, Paul says this, he says, be on your guard, stand firm in the faith, be courageous, be strong. I think you have to know that you have to live strong in faith. Because you can have strong faith or you can have weak faith. There is no in between. You gotta have strong faith, because if you don't have strong faith, you're gonna get off the journey somewhere at some point. Our mission as a church is we wanna take you on a journey to meet Jesus and fall passionately in love with him. It's a journey. So we have to continue to grow in our faith. I love this right here. He says, Paul's critical stance toward this is we don't wanna be passive about our faith as Christians. There are too many passive Christians in the world around us today. God wants you to live bold and courageous and strong, and that's why he says that in those scriptures right there. And if anybody can talk to us about faith, I think Paul's probably a good guy to talk to us about it. So we're gonna look at some of his writings. But he's, this devotional that I was reading, it says this line that I love, unguarded faith can be subject to changing situations, giving us a roller coaster ride, and then catch this, rendering our faith ineffective. Wow, man, so I wanna give you a premise. I'm gonna give you this idea and write it down, and I'm gonna unpack scripture. But if you're living a life of strong faith, that means you can have it the way you want it. And we're gonna look at this in scripture. You can have it the way you want it. God will allow you to live on whatever level your faith will settle for. It's completely up to you. We've talked about this a lot over the last several weeks, is that you can have as much of Jesus and what he brings as you want. It's all determined by your journey. You gotta be on guard so you can have it the way you want it. So I'm gonna kind of dive in here in Romans chapter 4 as we kick off. Again, I got a lot of scripture. I may not get to it all, but I'm gonna give you as much as I can so that we can really leave today and know how to, because here's the deal. Trove Heights Worship is awesome. Aren't they awesome? Trove Heights, they're so good, they're so awesome. But they are not gonna build your faith. They can maybe give you a little spark in here in the moment, but you have to build your faith. And so we're gonna look at what that looks like, because my goal, my job as a pastor is to equip you, equip the saints for the work of ministry is what scripture says. So my job is to help you know how to walk into Monday and know how to go strengthen your faith. Okay, so that's my goal today, is that you walk out and tomorrow you can wake up in the morning and you can begin to strengthen your faith this week. Anybody need some more faith? I need some more faith. I need some more faith. Go get some faith. Romans chapter 4, verse 17. I'd encourage you to dive into the book of Romans anytime you get a chance. The book of Romans, it's a good one. It'll help you. But Romans chapter 4, we're gonna look at verses 17 through 21 here as we dive into this. And this is Paul writing. He says, as it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. He's talking about Abraham. You can go back in Genesis and read about Abraham. He says, I have made you, how many of y'all remember that song? Father Abraham had many sons, and many sons had. All the church folks said amen, all right? And then your right arm, y'all know what I'm talking about? Y'all remember that? We're never gonna sing that song up here on the stage at Trove Heights, but it's always good to reminisce at times. He says, he is our father in the sight of God in whom he believed. The God who gives life to the dead and calls into being things that were not. Verse 18, against all hope, Abraham in hope believed and so became the father of many nations. So this is basically what he's saying. Abraham had no hope, so he kept hoping. There was nothing in the world around him that was giving any signal of hope. It's pouring down rain outside. There is no bit of sunlight. You can't even see it, but he kept hoping. Verse 19, without weakening his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead. I love that it says Abraham without weakening his own faith, because you can weaken your own faith. I love that right there. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead. Now, I'm gonna give you a paraphrase story. You can go back to Genesis and read it. In the chapters 30 through 40, somewhere in there, Abraham is about 100 years old. And God tells him, he doesn't have any kids. God tells him, you're gonna be the father of many nations. And he's like, hold up, bro. God, I'm 100 and I ain't got no kids. You tell me I'm gonna have a lot of kids. And he's like, he knows that this is technically, physically impossible. I don't know if y'all know that or not. That's probably not possible in today's environment anyway. So he says, he knows he's as good as dead since he's about 100 years old. and that Sarah's womb was also dead, his wife. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God. What did he tell you? What did he say to you? But he was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God. Verse 21, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. My goal today is that as we dive into this, I hope that you leave and you are fully and completely persuaded in the promises of God. That's my goal today. I have no other goal than just to fire you up and strengthen your faith. I need you to leave fully persuaded. If you come into Trove Heights and you leave on Sunday and you have no faith through the week, I'm not doing my job. I'm gonna help us get fully persuaded today. Ephesians 6:10, you gotta be strong in faith. It says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Now, let me give you a little thought here. You cannot be strong in the Lord unless you are strong in the Lord. And what I mean by that is if you are not diving into the word and into prayer and into worship, you will not be strong in the Lord. Coming in here and listening to Trove Heights worship will not get you strong. I'm just saying it's not going to. It can help you for a minute, but if you don't do anything between Monday and Saturday, you're gonna be a mess. You will not have strong faith. You have to develop your faith. Anytime you're strong in the Lord, you will have strong faith. Y'all ever get around them old church mothers? Anybody grow up in church? You get that old church mother. She's just praying in the back. You come in discouraged. Oh, Lord, you are more than a cuss. She just starts speaking. She's strong in faith. Never has a bad day. How many of you wish you just had a good old church mother waking you up on Monday morning being like, you are more than a conqueror? Wouldn't that feel good? It'd be great. Develop your faith. You got to develop strong faith. You got to be strong in the Lord. And I love how he says it in verse 10. Go read Ephesians 6 for yourself. But I love how he starts it with finally. He gives us all this stuff. Finally, be strong in the Lord, because that's what it all hinges on. As a church, we have four values. As a dream team, we talk about these a lot. Our first value is we are in love with Jesus. Then we have three other values. I'm not gonna give you those right now because I'm talking about being in love with Jesus and strong in faith. If you don't have that correct, the rest is not gonna work. I'm just telling you, the rest will not work. So you gotta be strong in faith. So I'm gonna give you another scripture. Actually, I'm gonna give you a bunch. I would just write these down. I'm gonna blow through these about 10 or 12 scriptures. I would just write down the references. Go back and look at them for yourself and chew on them, digest them, read them in the translation you like. We have Bibles out there. By the way, if anybody's in here and you need a Bible, you don't have a Bible, we have Bibles in the lobby. You can take one. They're yours. You already paid for them. Go grab a Bible. You can dive into the Bible with us, okay? Acts 26, verse 18 says this. It says that we are sanctified by what? Faith. We are sanctified by faith. Hebrews 11, 6, this says that without what? Faith, it is impossible to please God. Galatians 3, 14 says, by faith, we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Romans 1, 17, the righteous will live by faith. The righteous will live by faith. Romans 3, 28, a person is justified by faith. Romans 12, 3, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. 2 Corinthians 1, 24, by faith, you stand firm. By faith, you stand firm. Romans 14, 23, everything that does not come from faith is sin. That's bold right there. That's strong. Paul says, everything that does not come from faith is sin. Ephesians 6, 16 tells us to take up the shield of what? Of faith. Take up the shield of faith. Colossians 2, 7 says, you are rooted and built up in Jesus. Therefore, you are strengthened in faith. 1 Peter 5, 9, resist the devil, standing firm in the faith. So that what that tells me right there is you can never resist the devil if you're weak in faith. Go back to John 10, 10. The thief comes what? To steal, kill, and destroy. He's trying to steal your faith. Because if he can steal your faith, he can kill your walk towards more faith, and then he will destroy the dreams and the promises that God has put in your heart. It all goes back to faith. But if you don't have strong faith, you will never resist the devil. Never gonna happen. You gotta stand firm and resist the devil. So strong faith is important for every believer, no matter how long you've been on this journey. And here's the deal, you can always weaken your faith. That's why I love what it says about Abraham. I have to continue to strengthen and build my faith every day. The cool part about it is that there's no pinnacle in your faith. You can have as much faith as you want. You can build it for the rest of your life. I've been on this journey now following Jesus for 8 years. And for 8 years, I've just been trying to strengthen and build my faith. Because if I ain't got no faith, I can't come in here and strengthen your faith. Now, at times I think maybe I have too much faith to a fault, but I don't think you can have too much faith. You can have more and more and more faith. You gotta build your faith. You gotta strengthen your faith. But here's what you have to know today is you don't start out with strong faith. So to date, in 6 weeks, we've seen 23 people say yes to Jesus at Trove Heights. Man, that fires me up. That fires me up. Those 23 people don't start out strong in faith. We have to start out in faith, and then you have to strengthen it. You have to build it. Now, I'm going to do my best on a Sunday. Our team is going to do our best to give you a moment in the presence of God. I'm going to do my best to give you as much word and scripture. Because here's the deal. I can give you a lot of cool words, but those won't transform your life. The word of God will transform your life if you let it. So I got to give you the word. I'm going to give you the word today because we have to become strong in faith. Romans 4:19, it says again, without weakening his faith. So Abraham knew that God says, here's your promise, and Abraham could have shrunk back and weakened his faith in that moment. But it says that he decided, one scripture passage in one translation said that he resolved to strengthen his faith. What's your resolve? That was literally my prayer on the way in this morning. So cool thing, we've been loading in at 5 a.m. here at Trove Heights. Today we got to load in at 6 a.m. Y'all, that extra hour of sleep strengthened my faith this morning, okay? I was on the way in this is literally the prayer I was praying this morning. God, today I just resolve to give you my all. I resolve to give you every angle of my life this morning. I never get up here without strengthening my faith. So sometimes you gotta stir your faith up. That's why what we talked about last week is so important. You gotta get around the believers. People need church, because without church sometimes I have trouble strengthening my own faith. But when I can get in here with you, I'm gonna tell you the best way to grow your faith is this. You don't share, you gotta share your faith to grow it. Okay, you don't grow your faith to share it, you share your faith to grow it. I could have a bad day, but if you come up and I'm like, Chad, bro, let me tell you about what God did in my life. I'll start preaching, I'll start hollering, come on, God is good. I strengthened my faith by sharing my faith. Share your faith more. Don't be timid about sharing what God has done in your life. Share what God is doing in your life. It'll strengthen your faith. I'm telling you to strengthen your faith. 2 Corinthians 1:3, he says, we ought to always thank God for you. This is Paul talking to one of the churches in Thessalonica. He says, we always ought to thank God for you, brothers and sisters, and rightfully so. Why? Because your faith is growing more and more. You gotta know this today is the first thing, that God wants you to grow your faith. That's the first thing. God wants you to grow your faith. God did not save you to have weak faith. God did not save you so you can live a weak life. God saved you and then wants you to grow your faith. How do we do that? I'm gonna look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3. If you have your Bible, you can go there with me. We're gonna look at the first few verses, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Again, Paul, he's the guy. If you need to know how to build your faith, go read any of Paul's writings. All the eons. He wrote all the eons in the New Testament. All right. He says, brothers and sisters, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly, mere infants in Christ. So time out, side note right there. If you are living in the world, you cannot have strong faith. I'm going to say that again. If you are living a worldly life, you cannot have strong faith. If you live the same way the people who are living away from the church are living, you will never have strong faith. You got to be in church. You got to build the church. You got to read the word. You got to stop cussing. Come on, Christians, stop cussing. You got to strengthen your faith today, okay? We have to grow our faith. Verse 2, he says, I had to give you milk. He's talking to a church. I had to give you milk, not solid food, for you weren't ready for that yet. Indeed, you are still not ready. Paul was gangster. He walked in. He's like, all y'all are babies. I mean, he was gangster with it. Verse 3, you are still worldly, for since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, you are not worldly. Are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere humans? You can't be worldly and have strong faith. What he's basically saying right there is, as Christians, we have become so consumed with being consumers and sitting in the pew and fighting over a seat or where we go to church. No, you're supposed to come in and build the kingdom of God, strengthen your faith. We gotta grow our faith. And so what that requires is you have to get out of flesh and you have to get into building your spirit. Your life will be better than it's ever been when your spirit is better than it's ever been. Your spirit looks like Jesus. I don't know if y'all know this or not, but we were made in the image of Christ. Now, bodily, we have different pigmentation. We're different colors and sizes and shapes, different backgrounds. But the problem is too many of us are buying into who I am is my flesh. When you buy into who you are is your flesh, then you live a worldly life because you're worried about feeding body. So today is day 3, and I'm going to talk about this for the rest of time. As a church, since before we moved here, 18 months ago, we committed that the first 3 days of every month for the rest of time, the first through the third of every month, is gonna be 3 days of prayer and fasting as a church. And we started it sitting around my parents' kitchen table in Houston, Texas, when there's 4 of us. We're gonna pray and fast. Because if you start your month with 3 days of prayer and fasting, I'm telling you, it's gonna be really hard to look more like your flesh than your spirit. So I'm gonna talk a lot about prayer and fasting. That seems taboo in the world today within churches at times, but it's a foundational piece of who we are as a church. We will not do anything without allowing God to have full control. I don't wanna go into my month without it. I can't. I need to build my faith, y'all. I've had plenty of times along this journey over the last 18 months to weaken my faith. The moments where I wasn't feeling it are the moments I just pressed in. And sometimes that looks like dropping to your knees and crying out before God and say, God, I don't know what to do. Well, if you don't know what to do, do what you know to do. Hit your knees and go pray and strengthen your faith. That's what you need to do. That'll help you every single time. Most Christians have never grown up. That's really our problem. And that's what Paul talks about. All y'all are babies. 40-year-old Christians rolling in here in diapers. We ain't gonna do that no more. Not at Trove Heights, we're not gonna do that. My job is to help you strengthen and grow your faith. It starts with me. Every day I have to wake up and I have to ask God to help me strengthen my faith. I love the story in scripture. You see the Roman centurion, he asked Jesus to do something. And then Jesus said, do you not believe? And he said, I do believe, but help me with my unbelief. That's my prayer more times than not, because everything in the world around us, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He's gonna put things in front of you on the news and with people and at your job and you this, that, and the other. He's gonna put stuff in your way that makes you have unbelief. So I think one of the best prayers you can pray every day is, God, today I believe, but help me with my unbelief. That's a good daily prayer. I would encourage you to pray that. Help me with my unbelief today. Now we're gonna look at a couple things of why have most Christians not grown spiritually, and then I'm gonna give you some keys when we wrap up so that it can help you begin to grow. But the first reason that most Christians have never grown spiritually is this: they were never fed the word. Now I'm gonna break that down for a second, because I used to struggle with this. I grew up in church, I was fed the word, and I used to think, man, you got saved, you better go home and read the Bible right now. You better get through 4 translations. You better pray an hour before you do anything else. And that is, I told Megan yesterday, I said, you know, I've had this revelation, like, moms, how many moms we got in the room? You had kids, we have moms in the room. You didn't have the baby, and then the doctors and nurses put the baby over there, and then you're like, go eat something, baby. Don't work like that. You gotta feed the baby. You gotta nurture the baby. You gotta help feed the baby so it'll grow and get strong, because a baby can't feed itself. We have Christians that never got fed. Maybe it was in a church setting. Maybe you stopped going to church. Well, you can't feed if you get away from mom, if you will. You gotta get fed. You gotta get fed the word. So we grew up on all these crazy faith songs like Father Abraham had many. But I remember that today. It's about building your faith. It's not about how corny the song is. It's about building your faith. We need faith song. That's why at Trove Heights, every song that you hear is about lifting up the name of Jesus and building your faith. Because I'd rather sing the word. I wanna speak the word, I wanna sing the word, I wanna hear the word. You don't wanna hear Kevin, you wanna hear the word of God. You need the word of God. You need the word of God. Because look, I can get you going up here if I really wanted to. I get you going. Y'all, your boy, I rap, I make beats, I can sing a little song. I do, I'll get you going. I don't know what y'all want. What, y'all got any song requests today? Anybody got song requests? No, look, we can come in here, we can get fired, and we can never talk about the word of God. That will not build your faith. Y'all know that Kirk Franklin song, Do You Want a Revolution? Y'all know that song? I love that song. That song fires me up, but it will not build your faith if that's all you have. You need to sing the word, read the word, speak the word. You need to get it in you, and then you need to, is this helping anybody today? I'm just fired up today, okay? I'm fired up today because we need this. Matthew 4:4, Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Every word, this whole book will help you, every angle of it. Every angle of it is designed to point to Jesus and build your faith. Is this too strong for anybody? Is this good? Is this helping anybody? Faith, we gotta have faith. And here's the deal, here's why you gotta have faith, because the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, and babies can't go take their stuff back. The enemy comes to steal your faith. If you're a baby, you ain't gonna get it back. I'm gonna tell you right now, you're gonna leave the church, you can go back into a life of sin. That's every one of us. Babies can't take their stuff back. Matthew 11:12, Jesus says, from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has been subjected to violence and violent people have been raiding it. You wanna go get your stuff back, you're gonna have to go take it. Freedom is a bloody business. The enemy ain't gonna give you your stuff back. If he took it from you, he ain't gonna give it back. You better have some strong faith and step in and say, right now in the name of Jesus, I have the power to trample. I'm telling you, you gotta have strong faith, because you can't take it back, whatever the enemy takes from you if you're a baby. We gotta grow up, y'all. We gotta become adults. We gotta begin to feed on the word. Like, look, churches all over the place, we do this. If all I gave you was the good stuff that you put on your fridge, if that's all I gave you some Krispy Kreme every Sunday. You can't run a marathon eating Krispy Kreme every day. You need some cornbread. You need some chicken, some fried chicken. You need some hot chicken. You know what I'm talking about? You need some good food. You need a protein shake. You need something. You know, some of y'all were like, absolutely not. We'll never have a protein shake. Some green beans, some black-eyed peas. Come on, some collard greens. Come on, somebody, anybody know what I'm talking about? You need some strong food. You need some strong word up in you. And here's the deal. If you look in the Old Testament, you look at the children of Israel, they're in Egypt for 400 years. They get delivered out. They go into the wilderness for 40 years before they go to Canaan, the promised land. Every time they went to a new place, God changed their diet. Because you can't go to the promised land eating manna. You can't just chill where you can't be eating back here what you were eating and expect to keep going further in your faith. It's just not going to happen. You got to start feeding on the word. So look, again, we have Bibles out there. I believe they're English Standard Versions. You can jump into that. If you need something more simple, you can do what's called the Message Version. It's a paraphrase. And you never know what you're going to find in the Message Version. You might be reading through there and you're like, is this the recipe to Rice Krispie Treats? What is this right here? You don't know what you're going to get, okay? But it's Bible. You just need to consume the word. It doesn't matter how you consume it. Maybe you're like, I don't like the these and the thous. Your boy don't either. That's why I don't read the King James Version. King James had a weird way of speaking, okay? Weird lingo. Find what works for you and just read the word. Get some strong word up in here. Yeah, I'm going to help you with this as best as I can on a Sunday, but you got to know how to do it on a Monday. You got to go tomorrow. Yeah. How many of y'all want some cornbread now? Anybody want some cornbread now? I'm telling you, I want some cornbread. First reason is we've never been fed strong words. Second reason that we don't grow our faith is we don't act on the word. Now, this is the most important piece because, and Jesus said, don't just be hearers, you got to be doers. If you only hear the word, that will never help. So here's what I'm going to give you. The word of God will never change your life. Some of y'all are like, blasphemy. The applied word of God will change your life. If you don't apply the word of God and you just read it like a book, it ain't gonna help you. This is not a self-help book, y'all. This is the word of God. You gotta apply it. You gotta act on the word. Hebrews 5:12. I love how he talks about it in Hebrews. He's talking to the church again. You have been believers so long now that you ought to be teaching others. Listen, if you've been in church for 5 years and you're not leading a small group, you need to lead a small group. You need to be teaching some other people. There are babies who need help being fed who are brand new to their faith. And it's up to us to be the ones to lead them and strengthen them. We got to continue to build ourselves up and pour into other people. He says, instead, you need someone to teach you again the basic things about God's word. You are like babies who need milk and cannot eat solid food. For someone who lives on milk is still an infant and doesn't know how to do what is right. Verse 14, solid food is for those who are mature, who through training have the skill to recognize the difference between right and wrong. Training, growth. You got to grow. Now, I'm not sitting here like, y'all are a baby. Man, I went to church today and the pastor called me a baby today. That's not what I'm saying. I'm trying to encourage us to grow up in the faith, y'all. I need to develop strong faith. I need more faith than I've ever needed. Anybody else? I need more faith than I've ever needed. More times than not, that is my prayer, is God, I need you more today than I've ever needed you. That's not a bad prayer to pray. What if you prayed that every morning? I wonder what God would do. Hey, let me ask you this question. How strong do you think you can get your faith? That's just between you and God. How strong do you think you can get your faith? What if every day you woke up with the aim to, I'm gonna strengthen my faith today. I wonder what's gonna happen today if I read more of the word, or if I just pray, God, today, you're gonna bless me. Because scripture says that you are blessed when you come and when you go, when you're in the city, when you're in the country, when you're in the field. It don't matter, you are blessed as long as you keep pressing forward with Jesus. You're gonna be blessed. James chapter 1, this is what he says in verse 22. But don't just listen to God's word, you must do what it says. Otherwise, you're only fooling yourself. Verse 23, for if you listen to the word and don't obey, it's like glancing at your face in a mirror. You see yourself, walk away, and forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says, that's a big if, and then you don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing that. And we talked about this on week one, launch Sunday. The blessing of the Lord will make you rich. You can live rich in faith. You can live rich in relationships and rich in purpose and rich in all these things we're going to talk about over the next 4 weeks. But it matters, are you applying the word? Too many of us try church. If you try church, it ain't going to help you. You got to lean in and dig in and say, all right, God, today I'm going to lift a hand. Never lift a hand in worship today. God, I'm going to lift a hand in worship today. Maybe you start down here and you hold the baby, okay? All right. Then maybe you do one of the, whoop, I did it, 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 I did it. Take a step. Maybe you're like a window washer, like you just do like that, right? You figure out what works for you, but what if you tried something in your faith that you've never done? To go somewhere you've never been, you gotta do something that you've never done. You got to just lean in and try some new stuff in your faith today. Faith that doesn't move is not faith. It's just a thought. Faith moves. Faith acts. Faith presses forward. Faith does something. Faith will make you do something that you never would have done. But you got to have faith. So what if you woke up tomorrow and you had a stomach ache? What if instead of looking in the cabinet first, we prayed first? What if we had some scriptures on healing that right now, God, by Jesus' stripes, I am healed? What if that's how we prayed? And then we took the medicine in Jesus' name. And let's say you do that the first time, you're like, preacher said it, I'm gonna try it, and it doesn't work. Well, you know what? Thank God, God, you get all the glory. Hey, you know what, devil? Next time this happens, I'm gonna try it again. And you just try it again, and you just keep going. That's my message last week. Keep going. You just gotta keep going. Keep going to keep growing. Wake up, do it all over again. My man, Gene, I love you, Gene. You're a blessing to my life. You remind me of my why, bro. You remind me of my why. And me and Gene have all these conversations. And every time we talk, that's my only message for him. Bro, just keep going. Just keep going. Just keep strengthening your faith. Just keep going. I love this thought too, that the word isn't true because it works. The word is true because it's true. Whether it works for you the first time or not, the word is true, always has been, always will be. John 1:1 says that in the beginning was the word was with God, and the word was God. You want to know God? You need to read this word. We're sitting around waiting for a word from God, and he's like, bro, I gave you lots of words. Yeah, you just got to read it. You got to read it. There's lots of words in here, y'all. I'm just saying lots. 66 books worth. You can dive into all of them. Figure out what works for you. Romans is a good place to start. Romans 4:20, he says, yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God. I love that. He didn't waver in unbelieving. What would that look like for us? I'm challenged when I read Paul's writings. I'm challenged when I read about Abraham. How do I not waver? Because there could be a way, and I just solidified to get on the front row. We launched the church. We know how the stats work. You launch, and then you decrease in attendance. You decrease in attendance before you begin to grow, and the growth could be slow. It could be fast. We don't know what to expect. But I stand down there in that front row, and what I had a picture of was every seat filled by an angel, a heavenly host. And I thought, no, God, today I do it for the audience of one. I do it for you, Jesus, no matter who's there. And if that's always your aim, I'm telling you, you'll continue to grow in your faith. You got to keep growing in your faith, because there are no spiritual genetics. Did y'all know that? How many of y'all are a very gifted athlete? Anybody? Very gifted athlete, more than others. You're like, oh, I can play some ball. So some of us are more gifted than others. Some of us are taller. Some of us can run faster. Some of us can eat more. I don't know what your gift is, all right? Some of us are genetic. Some of us are smarter than others. A lot of y'all are smarter than me. But spiritually, did you know we all start at the same exact place? Nobody starts out like, oh, I'm just genetically more spiritual than you. Nope, nope. We all start at the same place. We got to grow it together. No more excuses. At Trove Heights, we are going to build the kingdom of God, and we're going to grow in our faith. We're going to grow in our faith. We got to grow in our faith. Hebrews 6:1, again, he says, let us stop going over the basic teachings about Christ again and again and again. If you need to have a word every time you come in here to go through your week, that's a problem. You need to get the word in you on a Monday. Is this too strong for anybody? I'm fired up. Y'all, we got to build our faith today. It took faith to get West End Middle School. We didn't know this was our school to launch the church until 32 days before launch day. We literally came in here by faith. I talked with the principal. He said, well, we got to have this conversation. We got to do that. We got to do that. And I don't know. So I just said, okay, great. I said, well, can we come in on Saturday and we'll clean up your football field? We'll pick up trash. We'll pick up everything. Can we do that? He said, yeah. So what he didn't know was we had a team of us in here picking up trash and praying around the school at the same time. In faith, God, this is going to be where we have church. We're going to launch this church. People are going to come to know Jesus. And I literally went home after telling the team, y'all, oh, it's going to be awesome. And I go home and I'm like, God, what are we going to do? Because what if they say, God, if they say no, we're going to have parking lot ministry out there. That's what we're going to be doing, parking lot ministry. God opened the door 32 days before. In faith, we prayed around this school. In faith, we believed. And it ended up being a bigger, better actual thing that happened than what we pictured in the first place. Because where we thought we wanted to be, y'all, traffic is terrible. Praise God, we're in West End Middle School. Come on, somebody. We got an awesome location. We got plenty of grass out there for all kinds of stuff. If you ever just want to come kick around a ball, you got grass out there. You can just come to church and go play ball. Do whatever you want. God has blessed us immensely, but it happened by faith. 1 Timothy 6:12, he says this, fight the good fight for true faith. You got to fight for true faith. You got to fight to live rich in faith. You got to fight to grow your faith. I don't know if you know this or not, but we are in a war. Scripture says that we are in a war. The principalities, it's all the spiritual world. There is a war happening, and you get to choose which side you want to play on. I'm just going to wake up every day and say, God, today I'm going to pray a hedge of protection over my kids. Right now, I pray favor, I pray influence, I pray protection, I pray that you speak to their heart. You got to start and you got to be in the battle. The only way you lose the daily battle is if you don't show up. That's the only way. You show up, you automatically have the God of creation on your side. You just got to show up. We got to show up on Monday because, again, God will allow you to live on whatever level your faith will settle for. You can have it the way you want it. The next thing you got to know is this. You have to start in faith, stay in faith, and finish in faith. Oh, it's a grind. You got many opportunities to take the exit and get off the path. You got to start in faith, stay in faith, and finish in faith. Because if you're walking by faith, it's going to cause you to walk into territory that you have to conquer. They wanted their promised land. They had to go conquer that thing. They had to go take it. So you're going to have to go conquer this. I love Matthew chapter 9. And this is what Jesus would say to you if he was in here. If he walked to you one by one, he came up to me, he'd ask you, what do you want me to do for you? He puts the ball in your court. And that's what you see here, verse 26. After Jesus left the girl's home, two blind men followed along behind him, shouting, Son of David, have mercy on us. They went right into the house where he was staying. And Jesus asked them, do you believe that I can make you see? Jesus wants to know about your faith. He doesn't want to know, do you have this in order? Are you got it all together? No, he just wants to know, do you believe that I can do this? Yes, Lord, they told him, we do. Then he touched their eyes and said, because of your faith, it will happen. You can have as much faith as you want to have. And because of your faith, whatever you need can happen. Yeah, I'm telling you, because somebody say amen to that. I'm telling you, because of your faith, you can have what you need. But too many times we go into prayer and we're like, God, I do this way too much. God has convicted me about this a lot lately. I'll pray, God, right now, you know the needs of the church. God, if it's your will, God, that's like a, I don't think you'll really do it. I want you to do this, but if it's your will, God, I'm okay if you don't. That is doubting. That is doubting faith. I don't even know if that's possible, but you're doubting. It's not faith. It is God's will that you have a rich and satisfying life. It's his purpose for you. But you gotta strengthen your faith. Because how many of you know the scripture says the promises of God are what? Yes and amen. Which means when you pray, you need to say, God, this is what I'm praying and believing for today. And in the name of Jesus, amen. What if you just what if you ended prayer time just all by yourself? God, yeah. Yes and amen. Those are the promises of God. Yes and amen. The next thing you got to know is in the kingdom, faith is your currency. Faith is your currency in the kingdom of God. Faith. Faith will do whatever you need it to do. The Bible talks about strong faith. It talks about great faith. Mark 4, it says there was no faith. Matthew chapter 14, it says there was little faith. Y'all know, Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water. That took some faith. If you don't think so, go home, run your bath water, and try to take two steps. Just see what happens. It took some faith. Everybody's like, he drowned. Peter, would you have got out of the boat? I probably wouldn't have got out of the boat. That took a lot of faith. Okay, master, if it's you. Okay, he took his eye off the word. It doesn't work for the world. This whole idea of faith doesn't work for the world. It only works if you're pressed into Jesus. In the kingdom, that's your currency. Next, you got to know that when you're in a battle, don't take your eye off the word. That's exactly what Peter did when he's walking on the water. When he looked around and saw the wind and the waves, it was there when he got out of the boat, but he was looking at Jesus. As soon as he got his eyes off Jesus, he began to sink. So when you're in a battle, you got to do that. Again, you got to have we got to stop going to Google before we go to God. We got to go to God first. We got to have some faith. We got to pray first. So at Trove Heights, we have a pray first culture, which is why the first 3 days of every month is prayer and fasting, because I will not do anything without including the presence of God. God's guidance is waiting on your participation. Too many times we're like, God, where do you want me to go? And he's like, just go and I'll show you. That's exactly what he did with Abraham, the father of many nations. He told him to get up and go to the land I will show you. And he said, where's that? He said, go. And he said, when do I stop? He said, go. Which way do I go? Go. I'll tell you when you get there. Should I keep going? Yep, you just go. I'll tell you when you're there. I can't say that I would have done that. That's why they call him the father of faith. Father Abraham and many sons. Father of faith. Faith being put to work. You have to put faith to work in order for it to be strong. Luke chapter 17, the disciples asked Jesus, I love this so much. Maybe you need to make this your prayer today when you leave. The apostle said to the Lord, show us how to increase our faith. I love that. They are with Jesus on a daily basis and they doubt. Which tells me, if we don't have Jesus in front of us, we will doubt. So I need some faith. They ask him, how to increase our faith? This was Jesus' answer. You should write this down because this is Jesus and he's talking to you and he's talking to me. He said, if you had faith, even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, may you be uprooted and be planted into the sea, and it would obey you. If you had faith as little, so which means little faith is enough faith. It made me question, do I even have faith at times? All you need is a little bit of faith. So how strong do you think you can get your faith? That was the question I posed. How strong do you think you can get your faith? Why don't you go home and see? What if we all went home today and this week I'm on a mission to see how strong I can grow my faith. What would that look like? We should continue to strengthen our faith. I love this. It says the tree would obey you if you had faith. So technically the tree obeys your what? Your faith. The tree doesn't obey you, the tree obeys your faith. I have no power in my words, but when I speak in the name, you just include the name of Jesus in everything. I'm telling you, it changes situations, but you gotta include that, you gotta speak in faith. If you have no faith, the tree won't obey him. So the storm obeyed Jesus by what? Faith. The fig tree did what it did by faith. The dead man, Lazarus, that had been buried for 4 days, got up because Jesus spoke in complete faith in his Father. All right? The woman with the issue of blood, her faith made her whole. Jesus wasn't even planning on it. He turned around and he said, who touched me? That tells me that at times you got to go to Jesus and you just wait and see what happens. I just need one touch. That's what she said. She had tried everything in the world. But if I could just a little faith, you could be made whole. Because the next thing you have to know is that your faith delivers the promise. Your faith delivers the promises of God. You want the promises to begin to become real in your life, you've got to operate in faith. Mark chapter 4, and I'm not going to read it, I'm going to paraphrase because I got way too much here. But Mark chapter 4, you see the parable of the seed and the sower, okay? Jesus talks about a sower goes around sowing all this seed, and he talks about all the different kinds of ground that it falls on. Some falls on rocky ground, some falls on this ground, that ground. Every type of ground that the seed falls on, the word is choked out. Except for the one that goes deep in the soil, and what it says is that it is exponentially grown 30, 60, 100 fold, which means your faith will either never grow or grow exponentially. So you could be in the first three categories, no faith. But if you're just in the one that's, and this is what that looks like. Again, the applied word of God. You read scripture, you digest it, and then you pray about what you just read because it's got to go from here to here. If it stays here, head knowledge is dead knowledge. I need some heart knowledge. I need the word of God in my heart because when it goes from here to here, then all of a sudden it begins to sink deep roots. And what can come out of you when the word is getting in you? You read the word when you don't need it, and it'll come out of you when you do need it. You need the word of God in your heart, not in your head, in your heart. I got to know the word. I've got to be able to speak into every situation and know the word of God. Because if you don't know the word of God, you have no power. The word will give you power. With much prayer, there's much power. You need prayer. You need the word. You need to worship. Before your kids make good grades, you got to get an image of them making good grades. And then you begin to pray about it. How's your imagination? How are you dreaming? What do you want to see God do in your life? You got to jump into that before you ever begin to pray about it. You've got to believe it and see it first. And that's the next thing you got to know is that God has seed for every need. God has seed for every need. Seed in the word. There is a scripture for every day that you'll encounter. Go read the book of Psalms. There's about 150 Psalms. You got essentially a Psalm for every other day. There is a song for songs. You got a word for everything you have in your life. So as a leader, as a pastor, before I was ever on a platform, my mentor, Pastor Keith Lindsay at Church of the Highlands, 8 years ago, used to tell me, you got to have a word. You always got to have a word. You always got to have a word. And what he was saying was, you can't lead other people if you don't have the word in you. You can't even lead yourself, first of all, but you'll never lead a body of people to get closer to Jesus if you don't know the word. I gotta have the word. So that's why I'm never gonna come up here without a Bible, without the word of God. I need the word in my life. God has seed for every need. Again, Mark chapter 4, this is how it starts, okay? First off, you gotta get rid of the world like we talked about because gossip and strife, that's designed to put weeds in your seeds. That Netflix show will put weeds in your seeds. Listening to Rick Ross will put weeds in your seeds. I'm just saying, you got to figure out what that looks like. That will put weeds in your seeds. How many of y'all want a nice looking lawn spiritually, if you will, a lawn? I want my yard to look good spiritually. That wasn't even in my notes. That's weird. But I need a good looking lawn spiritually. Put that in the notes after the fact. Mark chapter 4, verse 28, it says, the earth produces the crops on its own. First, a leaf of blade pushes through. Okay, you begin to see it. You're building your faith, so something's gonna sprout first. Is this helping anybody? You begin to build your faith, something will sprout first. So it's not just gonna grow overnight. It sprouts first. Then verse 29. As soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes and harvests it with a sickle. So it goes from blade, then the heads of wheat are formed, and finally the grain ripens. So it is a process. You gotta go through a process to grow and build your faith. Numbers 23:19. You gotta believe that God is able to perform what he promised. And so this is what I said, this is what I was thinking in my spirit this week, the performance of a promise. What does that look like? Numbers 23:19, God is not a man, so he does not lie. He is not human, so he does not change his mind. Has he ever spoken and failed to act? Has he ever promised and not carried it through? What that tells me is that our job is to receive, not to achieve. If it's based on your power, you might not. But if it's based on God's power and you just step back and give him complete control, God can do anything. Far more than you could ask or imagine, it says in Ephesians 3:20. I gotta build my faith. Isaiah 55:11, it says, it is the same with my word. I send it out. Guess what? It always produces fruit. Always. And it'll accomplish all that I want it to. It will prosper wherever I send it. That means the word does the work. And if you want to have more faith, Romans 10:17 says that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. The word does the work. Again, you got to get the word from here into here and then speak the word. The word does the work for you. The more faith you have, the more of God's ability you will have at your disposal if you do that. Because here's what Jesus said in John chapter 14. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but he says, I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, but guess what? Greater. So Jesus said that we can do greater works than he did. He said that. But how many of you read the Bible? I find myself doing that. I read the Bible and I'm like, raising the dead, God. I can't do that. But Jesus told us we could. He said, you can have it the way you want it, if you want it. But it's all about how are we believing. So this is all about growing up spiritually. We've got to continue to grow up spiritually. And as I close, I'm going to wrap up with this thought out of John chapter 6. And this is the feeding of the 5,000. If you've been around church any amount of time, you've heard this story. But I want to land on, as we've been talking about all this faith, strong faith, lots of faith, no faith, I want to talk about little boy faith for just a moment as we close today. Little boy faith. All you need is some little boy or little girl faith. That's all you need, just a little faith. It'll do a lot for you. John chapter 6, the story of the feeding of the 5,000. It says, after these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Then a great multitude followed him because they saw his signs which he performed on those who were deceased. So they saw something and they wanted it. Jesus went up on the mountain and there he sat with his disciples. Now the Passover, a feast of the Jews was near. Then Jesus lifted up his eyes and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, he said to Philip, check this out. Jesus said to one of his disciples, this is so good. He said, where shall we buy bread and these may eat? So Jesus presents a problem to his disciple and asks for a solution. Oh, just catch this for a second. But then it says right behind that, but this he said to test him, for he already knew what he was gonna do. Jesus always knows what he was gonna do. I love how he presents. So maybe today, Jesus is presenting a problem to you. Gene, what are you gonna do about this? Chad, what are we gonna do about this? Rachel, what are we gonna do about this? Jesus is asking you, but he is testing our faith. He already knows what he wants to do. Verse 7, Philip answered him. Oh, I skipped ahead a little bit. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have a little. Now, check this out. His response to Jesus' question was what he would naturally have to do. Basically, what he's saying is, Jesus, and if you look in different translations, he says, Jesus, it would take a whole year's worth of wages to feed that many people. Some scholars say 20,000 or more people when you include men, women, children. He's saying, Jesus says, how are we gonna feed them? And he says, God, I'd have to work a year for that. He answers God's question. He answers Jesus' questions with a natural response. But anytime Jesus asks you a question, he does not need your natural response. You know, you cannot help Jesus with a problem. I don't know if y'all know that or not. I can't help Jesus with a problem. He wants to know, how is your faith? And then I love right behind that. It says, a little boy came up. Verse 9. There's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what good is that with this huge crowd? Just doubt, just wavering. Jesus is like, oh, come on, guys. All right, go tell everybody to sit down. They all sat down on the grassy slopes. Then Jesus took the little boy, faith. He gave thanks to God for it. And he distributed all the loaves and fishes, 5 loaves, 2 fish, distributed to all the people. And afterward, he did the same with the fish. And they all ate as much as they wanted. The loaves came from a little boy's faith. a disciple who was a grown man gave a natural response to a supernatural question. But a little boy rolled up and said, I don't know what this will do, but maybe it'll do something. You can have it. I'll give you all I got and just see what happens. Because we talked about this the first couple of weeks of the church. The older we get, we lose our imagination. We lose our dreams. We start putting everything into logic. That's why Jesus said, you need to have faith like a child. So a child is constantly growing. When you become an adult, your growth is over. I am as tall as I'll ever be, unless God wants to do something awesome. I'm as tall as I'll ever be. I'm as fast as I'll ever be. I might be as strong as I'll ever be. But when you're a little kid, you can continue to grow. But you gotta be growing. So he says, you can have it. Jesus took it all, he gave thanks, he broke it. And then ultimately it says that they had 12 basketfuls left over. So they had to take the harvest off the seed back to the one that sowed the seed in the first place. Because anytime you give something to God, again, parable of the seed and the sower, God will take your faith and he'll exponentially grow it 30, 60, and 100 fold. So we live in a world of addition. God operates in a world of multiplication. What do you need multiplied in your life? What are you praying for addition for? And God's like, I'm gonna multiply that way beyond your wildest dreams. That's exactly how our journey started in ministry 8 years ago. I rolled into Highlands College and God, we were broke as a joke back then. We were too broke to pay attention back then. We ain't had no money, couldn't even pay our bill. We were just trying to figure it out, had a car taken. I mean, it was a mess. Life was rough. And I remember I get an opportunity to interview with one of the greatest pastors and churches in the world now today there in Houston, Texas. And over the course of months of conversations, I get a job offer. We were already broke, having trouble even paying our bills. They offer me a job, and the first thing I want to know how many of y'all want to know, I want to know how much is the pay. That's what I want to know, how much is the pay. Because my mom always said, you go into ministry, you ain't going to get a raise. I didn't care. I just said, how much? I ended up taking a $12,000 a year pay cut. I already wasn't making enough money. Now I'm giving up $12,000 that I need this. But over the course of 3 years, we've been tithing faithfully. We've been giving. We've just been giving everything. God, whatever you want, it's all yours anyway. We're going to live open-handed. You freely give, you freely take. And we give that to God and we make the move. We're all in. God, whatever you want us to do, we'll do. We trust you that you will provide. We go there. My parents lived in Houston, Texas. And I called them. I said, look, I know I'm like 33 years old, but I'm going to need to come live with y'all. Move my family, my two young boys. We move in the house with my parents. My brother, my sister lived there. Wasn't enough room for all of us, but we're just doing it. We're making the sacrifices. And I told them, hey, in 3 months, we'll move out. And then I'm like, God, in 3 months, I'm gonna need you to help us move out. That was literally how it happened. And I'm just faithfully serving, just faithfully doing whatever I can to just help people meet Jesus. And one night, I mean, every week like clockwork, I would text my pastor, can I do anything for you? Can I pick up your dry cleaning? Can I drive you somewhere? Can I feed you? What did you need? You know, anything. Every week it was the same thing. No, I'm good, bro. Thanks, man. I'm good. And on this random Thursday, about 3 months after we got there, he texted me back on a Thursday night. He said, we had two Saturday night services. He said, you can host the services on Saturday night. Kind of like when I walk up behind the worship and I give a little word there to fire us up before we get in the way. He said, you can do that. You can give all the announcements, do that. And I was like, I had never done that. I'm like, are you serious? Yep, you can do it. So I go in that first Saturday. I mean, I practiced like crazy. I was so nervous up there. I was like, God, what if I say the wrong thing? What if I say the wrong church name, God? What if I do something crazy? I don't know what I'm gonna do up here. And I did that first service. And afterward, in between the first and second service, he asked me to come back to the ready room where he was at, where he would kind of get ready for his messages. And he sat us down, him and his wife and me and Megan, he sat us down. He said, man, you did such a great job. I'm gonna have you do the other one tonight and I'm gonna have you do all four services tomorrow. I was like, wow. And then while we're like, oh my God, he goes, oh, and by the way, we want you to launch the Katy campus. We were one church in one location and we were launching a satellite campus. And he asked me to be the campus pastor. I was as unqualified as I could be. I just stepped on the stage for the first time in my life and said something in a microphone. Like, I didn't know what I was doing. But he said that and I thought, wow. So after that was all over, I went head held high. I was the best service host ever. I was like, come on, y'all, go to Growth Track. I mean, I was on fire. I was ready. And after the service, our CFO pulled me aside in the hallway. Everybody was leaving. He said, I don't know if Pastor Jeremy told you, but along with that promotion, we're gonna give you a raise. And I was like, oh, I was like, wow, you know, that's amazing. And he goes, it's a $12,000 raise. Now, if you remember back to the beginning of the story, I had a $12,000 pay cut. and God provided a $12,000 raise. Now, that's only the beginning. That's only the beginning. We begin to do what we do. We start a freedom ministry. The campus is growing. People are getting saved like crazy. It's unbelievable the growth that is happening at this thing. 18 months later, they asked me to go launch another campus, go launch the next satellite campus. And I go, and guess what came behind it? Another $12,000 raise came right behind. God just kept exponentially growing and doing more and more and more. And then fast forward to today, here's how God did with our little that we had. And we thought, God, I don't know if this could ever work. We had about 25 or so people that moved across the country from Houston, Texas with us to start this church. And many of whom are still here today helping lead and serve and do what we're doing here today to just help people meet Jesus. And because of it, 23 people have said yes to Jesus. People are going through the growth track. People are in small groups. People are joining the team. God is doing something. He's doing more than we can see because God is everything that we need. But it all started with a step of faith saying, here's my 5 loaves and 2 fish, God. There's way too many to feed, but maybe you can do something with this. Because of your faith, God will do whatever you need him to do. What is your step of faith gonna be after today? This is how I wanna leave you today. Romans chapter 12, Paul says this, and so this is what I'm gonna say to you, to all of us here today. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Remember how we ended the worship set, Christ alone, the cornerstone. God, we're gonna remember today, because of all he's done for you, let them be a living and a holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. You know how you please God? Faith. God finds acceptable through your faith. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Because of the privilege and authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning today. This is Bible, and it was good 2,000 years ago. It's still good today. Don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith that God has given us. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Today, I want you to take a moment and give yourself an honest evaluation of your spirit, of your faith, of where you're at. Be real with God right now. It's just you and God. Nobody's looking around. Nobody's in your area. This is one-on-one, you and God. And God's saying, you can have as much of me as you want. You can have as much faith as you want. I can give you whatever you want to see happen, but it's all dictated by where you are. So evaluate yourself. And if you're in here and you know, I've never even put my faith in Jesus. That's the first step. You got to start the journey. And maybe today you need to be strengthened in your faith. And if that's you, I'm gonna pray for us, and then we're gonna let God do what he wants to do. So right now, God, I just ask you, strengthen our faith. God, help us with our unbelief today. I pray that in this service, you're speaking to our heart, you're speaking to us about where we need to go, take next steps on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday. I pray that you strengthen our faith today. Anybody who's been wavering, God, I pray that right now you give them a little bit of a faith lift. Strengthen their spirit, my God. Help us walk out of here today with our spirit held a little higher, our heads a little higher because of what you are doing in us. I pray that you spark us today in Jesus' name. And if you're in this room and you've never put your faith in Jesus, then this is the best opportunity of your life, is to put your faith and trust in God. And so again, every head bowed, every eye closed. If that's you, say a prayer with me, something like this. Say, Jesus, today I give you my life. Today I put my faith and my hope in you. I believe with my heart and I confess with my mouth. You are Savior, you are Lord. I will put my faith in you for the rest of my days. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. Come on, can we celebrate anybody that just said yes to Jesus? Come on, man. That's why we do this. Maybe you're watching the online service and you said that prayer. You have a next step as well. We all have next steps. In this faith journey, there's another step. And so if you just said yes to Jesus, whether right here or online, you can text the word commit to the number 94090. It's on the screen. Or you can write it on your physical Connect card. If you're in here, I would encourage you to do that. That is a safe card, a safe form to fill out if you do that on the online through the digital opportunity there. We're not gonna call you. We're not gonna come to your house, deliver you pizza. We're not gonna do anything crazy. We're gonna send you an email that says, thank you for joining us. And we're gonna give you some next steps. Because you're never gonna grow until you take a step. So take some steps today. We wanna help you with that. Right there online, right here in the room, we're gonna help you with that. And let's grow in our faith. Does anybody feel stronger in your faith today? You feel stronger in your faith today. Gotta grow in our faith. And there's all kinds of ways you can do that. Beyond this service, you can go through Growth Track right after this.